गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल। यस, गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल। Today we are going to start with a new topic which is known as exception handling. Do anyone have an idea what do you mean by an exception handling? See, exception handling is nothing but when you're executing your program, you might have get an error. So when you got an error, your program stops execution then and there itself and it will come out of your program. So rather than coming like that out of the program, we can terminate your program normally. Okay. For that, we are going to make use of exception handling. When you're executing your program, you may get an error. When you got an error, what the JVMs will do, it will stop the execution there itself and it will come out of the execution. So rather than terminating like this, we can terminate the program normally. Okay, when you got an error, terminating immediately in the sense, for that we are going to call it as an abnormally. So rather than terminating your process abnormally, we can terminate your process normally. To terminate your process normally, we are going to use a concept called exception handling. Okay? It's an abnormal condition that occurs at runtime given by the JVM. So like example, when you're executing your program, you may get divide by zero. Okay, you may get, or you may give us a execution like divide by zero. For this, we are going to get an error. So at that time, what it will do, it will stops here and execute, I mean it will come out of your execution. For this we are going to call it as an abnormally. For this we are going to call it as an abnormal termination. To avoid this, we are going to make use of exception handling concept. Now coming to the next, there are two types of exceptions. One is checked exception, another one is unchecked exceptions. Okay, one is checked exceptions, another one is unchecked exceptions. Now what do you mean by an unchecked exceptions? When it will occur, in the sense, when we have written a bad code, at that time unchecked exceptions will generate. Like example, divide by zero, this is a bad code, we know that we will get some error. So even though we will write this divide by zero, at that time it is a bad code, so we are going to get an unchecked exceptions. Next, checked exceptions, when it will occur, in the sense, it will occur when the environmental and business failures, like sometimes the memory storages we may get error. Sometimes we may get some, resources which is required for execution. At that time, they may fail. At that time, we will get a checked exceptions. Unchecked, bad code, checked exceptions like environment and business failure. Okay, these are the two types of exceptions we have. Now, coming to the structure of your exception, the first is throwable class. First is a throwable class. First, what we have, this is throwable class. Okay. Under the throwable class, we have two different types of classes. One is an exception class, another one is error class. Again, under the exception class, we have four different types of exceptions. One is remote, another one is runtime, another one is input, another one is SQL. SQL, which will be comes under your databases, where input, output, runtime, and remote. And whereas coming for the another side, which we have error, these are the internals, out of stack memory, and out of memory. Okay. Now, here coming to your exception side, again, we have different types for this runtime. Again, class casting, null pointer exception, arithmetic exception, array out of array index out of bound exception, number formatting, casting. Everything will come under your runtime. Why? Because when you're running your program, then only we will get to know what type of logic you have written, where you got an error. So for these all things will come under your runtime. Okay, now this will come, all these things will come under in your runtime. Okay, now this is the just a classification of your exceptions, where throwable is the main class. Exception and error are the just derived class of the throwable class. Again, under the exception, remote, input, output, runtime, SQL are the derived classes of exception class. Again, under the runtime, again, we have different types of classes. Okay, it is going to make use of a concept called inheritance. Inheritance concept is going to make use of it here. Okay, so these are the child classes, and these will be the parent for the classes and everything. For runtime, parent will be the exception. For exception, parent will be the throwable class. So what all the methods which are present in the throwable class, it can be accessible by the runtime, class cast, null pointer. Same way, what all the methods which are present in the throwable can be accessible by the error. What all the methods which are present in the throwable, error, internal, out of stack memory, and out of memory are accessing. Have you understood the classification of those exceptions? Students, if anyone have a doubts, you can ask me. I'll explain it once again. Students, is it clear for everyone? Students, is it clear for everyone? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Now, next. For what reasons this exception will occur? What are the three reasons we have? Okay. The first thing is barcode. When we write a barcode, a damn sure exception will generate. Second, environment and business failures. Like sometimes memory allocation or for sometimes the resources which are required for the execution, those resources are not available for execution at that time. Second, which is occurred in the JVM. Some faults may occur in the JVM. For these three reasons, we are going to occur an exception or error. Based on these three reasons only, we may occur exceptions or errors, and make sure that any reason will be this. Most of the times we will make use of this. If you want to occur any exception, we most of the times, 95% of times, we are going to make a problem with the barcode. Okay. Next, whenever we get an exception of the program, gets terminate abnormally. Like example, that's what I've said in the previous class. When you do divide by zero, we are going to get an abnormal termination of your program. At that time, what should you do? This is an abnormal termination has done. If you want to terminate normally, what we have to do? Now we have a problem here. See, when you return a bad code, automatically it will terminate abnormally. Now I'll get a question, how to terminate normally? How my execution should go smoothly and terminate normally? In the sense, here we have a solution for that. What is that? In the sense, we have to make use of try-catch block. We have to make use of try-catch block. To overcome the subnormal termination, we are going to use a concept called try-catch block. Now let's jump into this. What do you mean by try-catch block? Now coming to the structure of your try catch block, how it will be in the sense. First, we are going to have a try method. Under this try, sorry, it is not try method, it is just a try, just a block, I can say try block. Okay, and in this try block, you can write any executable statements. You can write any executable statements. Under this try, any executable statements. If you found any error here, if you found any error here, from this error, we are going to come up with one method. Whatever you have found it here, it will jump into this block, catch block. If you found any error, automatically it will jump into the catch block. It will execute here and your program terminates normally. Program terminates normally. If you want to terminate your program normally, then we have to make use of try catch block. Okay, the syntax is very similar. First, you have to write a try block. Under this try block, you can write whatever the code if you want to write it. Once in that particular try block, if they found any error, it will get back to your catch block. Under this catch method, you have to write specific error part. Like suppose if you are generating null pointer exception here, you have to specify here whatever you want to print. Okay, then once it is executed here, it will come out of this catch block and whatever the statements you have here below the catch block, it will execute and it will terminate the program. Is it clear for everyone? Students, is it clear for everyone how to make use of try catch block, how it will execute? Yes, I need an answer from you people. I need answers. Rakshita, Chandana, what about the others?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Okay, this is just simple structure. Now, next, moving to the executional sequence. How the execution works when you make use of try catch block. I have a main method. Under this main method, I have one try block where dotted lines are some executable codes. Okay, where dotted lines are executable statements. Next, under this try block, again I have a catch block. Again, under this catch block, I have some executable statements. Under this catch block, again, I have some statements to execute. Now I'll execute, I'll explain for you how the flows goes here. Suppose example, if you find out an error, okay, if you found an error here, what it will done, it will enter into your catch block. The catch block will execute successfully. Once the catch block executes successfully, it will come to the come out of your catch block and it will start execution of this lines. Up below the catch block, how many lines you have, those will be executed. Okay. Now what it will happen, just this is the first concept. Suppose example, if you have not found any error in this try block, so try block will execute successfully and it will not enter into the catch block. Directly it will come to the point below the catch block, what all the statements you have, that will be going to get executed. Okay, this is a second point. These are the two points you have to remember in your mind. First, if you have found any error, it will jump to the catch block. In the sense, it will search somewhere, okay, I have a catch block or not. If it is there in catch block, it will jump into the catch block. If not, it will abnormally terminate your program. It's there and then and there itself. It won't execute next below statements. If you have a catch block, it will enter into the catch block. It will execute the statements. It will come out of the catch block. It will check whether any statements are there to execute. If it is there, it will execute the statements. Okay. Now, my question is, I need everyone to answer. Suppose if I found an error in this line, whether this line is going to be get executed or not? Whether this line will execute or not? I have a question. If the first line founds an error, whether the second line will execute or not? The answer is no. Why? Because if the error founds here, immediately it will check to the catch block. If the catch block is present, it will enter into this catch block and it will start executing of that particular catch block. That's it. This is the sequence of your catch block. Okay, just wait in the previous block awareness. Make sure that where I can make use of try catch block. You can make use of try catch block in the constructors, methods, and initializers. Okay, constructors, methods, and initializers. These are the three methods or three concepts which you can make use of your try catch block. Okay, now what we are going to look into this here, you have to check, you have to write in the catch block, you have to pass one parameter. What parameter you have to pass in the sense? In the try block, if you found a null pointer exception, then it will come to this particular catch block. It will check whether any null pointer exception have been written in the parameter. If then this null pointer exception and this point null pointer error have matched, then it will enter into this catch block and this catch block is going to get executed. Then it will come to your next line execution. Understood what I have said? See, whenever you're writing, whenever you're passing a parameter to the catch block, you have to check whatever the error you're generating in the try block should match your catch block parameter. If it is matching, then it will enter into this particular block, catch block. Otherwise, it won't execute your catch block. Understood what I have said for you people? Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. Suppose example, if you got an error divide by zero, if you got an error divide by zero, so what should you do? So here you have to write, there is a class called divide by zero. In the place of null pointer, you have to write divide by zero. And then you have to declare one variable. That's it. Is it clear? Yes or no? I need answers from you people. Why? Because this concept is very, important. Okay. Now, for one try block, can we have n number of catch blocks? Like example, try, catch. Here a null pointer exception, I'll write it. Again, here I'll write catch. Here I'll write it arithmetic exception. Here I'll write catch. Here I'll write it array index out of bound exception. Open and close parenthesis. Can I write like this?
Yes.
For one try block, I can write any number of catch blocks. Why? Because why we are going to write a number of catch blocks in the sense, suppose example you might have written here divide by zero error. We don't know, we will get in some divide by zero error. Okay, so here we should write all the exceptions, all the exceptions, like stating from array bound of exception, runtime, exception, throwable, like this. Okay, we have to write this catch block from specific to generic. Specific to generic we have to write. Okay, I'll come back to this point. Now I'll show for you people. See here, we have a throwable picture. You can check it out. We have to write null pointer exception first. Then you have to write runtime. Then you have to write exception. Then you have to write throwable. Okay. Suppose example, if you didn't get a, if you want to write all these things like class cast, first you have to write, then you have to write null pointer, then you have to write arithmetic, number format, array index, then you have to go for runtime, then you have to go for exception, then you have to go for throwable. Okay, I'll show for you people how to write in the sense. Notepad. Suppose I have pipe. I want to mention all the catch blocks. So what I should write? I should start writing the catch blocks in such a way that first it should be pointed to the specific class, then it should be go on for generalizing. Generalizing comes for the main class. Okay, can anyone say that what is the main class of your exception? Parent class? What is the parent class for your exception class?
So throwable.
Throwable is the parent class for your exception class. Okay, now catch. First I'll write it class cast. Class cast E. Okay, this is specific class. Now again I have to write another one. If you want to write another one catch block, catch, you have to write number format. Number format. So I'll write it some declaring of variable, another one. So again I'm going to write catch block. Again I'm going to write it here array index out of bound exception. Array index out of bound exception, right? E. Okay, now can anyone say what is the parent for all these classes? What is the parent class here for class cast, number format, array index? Who is the parent for all these classes? Check it out here. Who is the parent for all these classes? Yes, who is the parent for your class cast, null pointer, array index, out of bound exception?
Runtime.
So you have to write catch and runtime and some variable like this. Now under this runtime, if you have a number of classes similar, I mean for the siblings, like you can write it here catch, you can write it here remote exception and R. Here you can write a number of siblings. Again, from this, who is the parent for runtime and remote exception?
Exception, sir.
Exception. Catch, exception, E. Then you have to write like this. Okay, now again, catch. Who is the parent for your exception? Throwable. So, T. Like this. you have to start writing the catch block from specific to the generic. You can have a number of catch blocks under the try block, but you have to write your catch blocks in such a way that specific to generic you have to write. And this is the best practice to write it. Okay, and save the code. That's it. Is it clear for everyone? Is it clear for everyone? Do anyone have a doubts? Next, I have a main method. Later we will move to the execution part. First, I'll explain the concepts. Why? Because here you should know how the flow works. Okay. First, try block. I have a catch block. I have a runtime exception. Now, say me whether this syntax is correct or wrong. Whether this flow, what I have written, this try catch block and the parameters, whether it is correct or wrong. Yes. Whether try block is correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What about the catch block? See, catch block, if I say the catch block, you have to check the parameters and you have to say whether it is correct or not. See, the syntax wise it is correct, but make sure that here first it is your generic class and later you have a specific class. When you got an error here, automatically it will jump into your exception and here it will execute. It won't come for your runtime exception. Why? Because this runtime, it is already present in your exception. Whatever error it is required to solve, it is present in an exception class. So you need not be write your catch block. So the code what you have written here for your catch blocks, the sequence is wrong. What it need to be in the sense where runtime should be above and where exception should be below. The correct code is here. Okay, the correct code has been shown here. Kindly have a look on it. Where runtime is your specific code, where exception is your general code. That's it. Is it clear? Have you understood? Yes or no? Say me. See, guys, it is a programming language. You should say yes or no. If you understood or not, you have to say me. Rakshita, Prakruti, Trupti, Nimala, Girish.
Understood.
You have to say open your mouth and say me, or else you put a message. I'll have a look on it. Okay, now coming to the next question. If we have 100 exceptions in the try block or some code, so at the try block, whether do we have to write 100 catch blocks? If you have 100 exceptions, whether we have to write 100 catch blocks? I'm posing a question. Give me answer whether it is correct or wrong. I'm here to correct. If I have 100 catch blocks, sorry, 100 exceptions, whether I have to write 100 catch blocks?
No, sir.
The answer is exactly no. Why? Because all the exceptions which are storing in one class, which is called as throwable class, we can directly make use of throwable and T. In this statement, you have to place here in the place of exception, you can place throwable T for n number of exceptions. See, whatever you have error, you get it. throwable will be going to handle. Why? Because throwable is the major parent class. Everything you are going to have there. So you're going to access, you're going to solve your problem with your throwable class. Make sure that if I have 100 exceptions, we need not to write 100 catch blocks. We can make use of either throwable or exception. Okay. For most of the times, we are going to make use of 90% we are going to make use of exception class, or some percentage we are going to use throwable class. Okay. Is it clear? Next. Can we get an exception in the catch block? In the sense, can we get an error in the catch block? I'm asking for you people. Can we get an error in the catch block? Yes or no? My answer is yes. We can get an error or exception in the catch block. Why? Because the catch block, in the catch block, we are the one who are going to write the code. So sometimes if we write any business logic in the catch block, surely we are going to get an error if you have written a code wrongly. So what we have to do to avoid this, most of the times we should not write any business logic in the catch block. Just we have to print the error message through the catch block. Understood? Can we get an exception in the catch block? In the sense, the answer is yes. Why? Because if there is a chance of writing a business logic in the catch block, if you have written a wrong business logic code, business logic in the catch block, then you're going to get an exception. So what we have to do, we should avoid writing a business logic in the catch block. Me? I have written this catch. Okay, fine. Now, suppose what it'll do, program starts execution here. Try has executed successfully and it is entered into this particular try block. Execution of this line. Now say me, if I got an error here at this line, first line, this first line, which catch block is going to be get executed? Whether this, I'll write it first and this I'll write it second one. Now say me, whether first catch block will execute or second catch block will execute. If I get second an one. Error,
second. Second one, sir.
Exactly. If I get an error in the first line of the try block, so here we have not entered into this try block. So what it will do here, we got an error, directly it will jump to the catch block. Okay. And it won't check what type of exception we got. Why? Because we have written a parent class called exception. Here we are going to manage all types of exceptions. So we have written exception E. It will check whether it is going to handle that particular error in this class. If it is handles, it will enter into the catch block and this catch block is going to be get executed successfully. Okay. If I've got an error within this try block. Okay. Now you can check it out. This is successfully executed all the statements. And now within this try block, the statements are going to be get executed. Within this try method, if I got any error, then it will jump into this particular catch block and it will execute the statements. And this will be going to get execute the statements. Okay. Now, if you don't have any error here, it will not enter into this catch block. It will execute here. It will, execute successfully here. This will not get into the picture. It will come out of this catch block, all the catch blocks, and it starts executing here. done. Now, I'll give a solution for you. I mean, I'll give one problem for you. Well, give me 1 minute. Where I have a main method. Under this, I have a try block. Okay, under this try again, I have one catch block. Done. That's it. What here I'm going to do? I have 1, 2, 3 statements. I have one method which is called as M1. And I have another 3 statements here. Now what I'll do? Again, I'll come back to the, I am calling one method which is called as M1. So now in some class, I have declared M1 method. I have declared one M1 method. I have here, okay, opening statement. I have written some statements. And here I have, I'm calling some method which is called as M2 method. Okay, again I have some methods and I'm closing here. Again, somewhere I have declared M2 method. Okay. And here what I'm going to do, I have some statements to execute. What is going to be done here in the sense? Okay. Execution flow, I'll explain for you people now. Now, yes, it comes here try block. Now with the try block, it will enter into the try block. All these 3 statements are successfully executed. Now it will check M1 has called. So what it will do, it will jump to the M1 method. Okay. Now here all these methods are successfully executed. It will jump to this M2 method. In the method 2, somewhere I found an error. So rest of the statements are not executed. It will come back to this particular line. Rest any number of statements are also not going to be get executed. Again, control comes to this particular location. Again, rest all the 3 lines are not going to be get executed. It will check what is that error they have found in the M1. Whatever the found error, here you have to write throwable class. It will check whether that error is going to be get catchable with this catch block or not. If it catches, it will enter into the catch block. It will execute and it will come out of your catch block and your program terminates normally. Students, is it clear for everyone? Have you understood the concept? Yes or no? Students, have you understood the concept? How to make use of try catch block, how the sequence moves from one place to the another. Okay, fine. Next, what we have to do here in the sense, okay, till now I have explained try catch and everything. I have not explained for you how to print that error. So here what I'm going to do is, for the throwable class, for a throwable class, there are 2 methods. The first one is print stack trace method. And later we have get message method. Using these 2 methods, I can print the error what you have found in this particular try block. Okay. Like example, here you might have written throwable T. So what I'll do here, what I can write it, I can write system dot out dot println T dot print stack trace. Print stack trace. So what is going to be done here? What all the methods, sorry, what is an error which is found in the try block that is going to be printed in the stepwise? In the stepwise, we are going to print that particular error. In the same way, we can directly make use of T dot. Okay, in this, rather than using SOP, we can make use of T dot get message. So what we are going to be directly will going to be print on the screen. Directly we are going to print the message on the screen. Okay. Have you understood? Is it clear for everyone? The concepts are clear for everyone. Do anyone have a doubts? Students, do anyone have a doubts? Yes, I'm asking for you people. Do you have any doubts? Okay, fine. Now we'll start executing of the codes with using a try catch block. Now I'm going to create one class. New class. I'll show for you people how to get array index out of bound exception. So here what I'll write it, I create one class called test using public static void main method finish. Okay, under this, what I'm going to write, just I'll write system, three printing statements I'll write, system.out.println. All right, hi. Okay, now system.out.println. args of zero. System.out.println. Goodbye. Okay. Now we are going to get an array index out of bound exception. Why? Because I have not passed any command line arguments here. Just without passing any argument, I'm extracting the argument to print on the console. So now we will execute and we will check. Here you can check it out. We have got an error. First one is successfully printed. But now here at this level, have not passed any arguments. But even though I'm getting an error, so what I have to do, sorry, so we will get an array index out of bound exception. Here you can check it out, java.language.arrayindex out of bound exception at test.java 7th line. Is it clear for you people how to generate array index out of bound exception? Okay, next, now I'll explain for you. Null pointer exception. Okay, I'll explain for you null pointer exception. In the same test class method, what I will create, one method I'll create which is of static int count. have not initialized this count value. So what I'm going to do, I'll create one method which is called as test. I mean constructor I'm going to create here. Now what I'll do, count plus plus. Okay, I'm going to just increment my count whenever I'll call the test object. So in here, in the test class, what I'll do, just I'll remove this and I'll create one object. I'll create one object, test t is equal to new test, open and close parenthesis, give semicolon, that's it, save the code. Now you're going to get a null pointer exception. Why? Because I have not initialized any value for the count variable, even though I'm incrementing. So we have to get an error. What advent? Oh, sorry. Give me 1 minute. It is that t is equal to null. Sorry, it went wrong. Give me 1 minute. So system dot out dot println t dot count. T dot count. Why am I directly calling with the, okay, you have created text. Sorry. Now I'll save the code. Now I'll run. It has to get null pointer exception here. Here we have to get a null pointer exception. Give me 1 minute, I'll cross verify with this. Okay, I'll check it out somewhere. I've done a mistake. I'll check and I'll get back to this for this. Okay, now I'll come back to this arithmetic exception. Arithmetic exception, how to generate for this. Okay. What I'll do, int I is equal to 5. Okay, j is equal to 0. I have done. So what I'll do here, system dot out dot println I by j. That's it. And I'll save the code. See here we got it. Java dot language dot arithmetic exception divide by 0. So clearly we know that divide by 0, you're going to get an exception. So the divide by 0, we have got an arithmetic exception. This is how we can generate. So here we have an abnormal termination of your programs. Here completely how the programs till now, or three programs have shown an error. These three programs are terminated abnormally. Your process are terminated abnormally. To avoid that, we are going to make use of try-catch block exceptions. Try-catch block, concept. Okay, now we will implement try-catch block concept. Okay, first what I'll show, I'll come up with a simple example. Okay, first I'll come up with a simple example. Public static void, I'll remove this also. Here what I'll do, I'll just write try and I'll write this. Okay, in this try block, what I'm going to create? I'm going to create one array int a of is equal to new int of 2, and I'll give semicolon. Here what I'll do, system dot out dot println access of element 3. Now what I'll do here, a of 3, and I'll give semicolon, that's it. A of 5 plus semicolon, that's it, and I'll save this code. See, after the try block, I'm going to write a catch block. Catch, can anyone say what type of error we are getting here? Can anyone say what type of error we may get here? Trupti, Prakruti, Rakshita, Girish, Ishas, Ishkumar. Can anyone say what type of error? Array index out of bound exception we will get. Why? Because you can check it out. Have declared here only 2, 0 and 1. But even I'm accessing a of 3. Nowhere the element is existing in the memory. Why? Because a of 0 and a of 1 is there. That's it. A of 3 will not get executed. Why? Because the size is, array size itself is 2. So the element is not present. So here what I have to do, here I have to pass a parameter. Like array index out of bound exception. Index out of bound exception. Right? That's it. Now what I'll do, array index out of bounds exception. So now I'll write it system dot out dot println. Okay, here I'll write it just e and I'll give semicolon. Save the code and run the code. So here you can check it out. Now your program terminates normally. Java dot language dot array index out of bound exception, index 3 out of bounds for length 2. So what I have said, after executing catch block also, if you have any remaining statements, the system will execute. So I'll write it system dot out dot println both sem students are very good. I'll give semicolon. Now the statement will print. Why? Because however the your execution of your program is terminated normally because of your catch block. Okay, done. This is of your array index out of bound exception. So make sure that rather than, I mean, can we write like this array index out of bound exception? See, when we have written a code and if we are writing like array index out of bound exception catch block, whether is it a feasible code? Whether is it a feasible code? Make sure that it is not a feasible code. Why? Because if you're clearly specifying that your catch blocks catches this type of exception only, then you're clearly saying that there is an error in my code before execution itself. So make sure that whenever you're writing, you should not write array index out of bounds exception. Okay, when they clearly specifies that generate array index out of bound exception, then you have to write this type of code. Now we will jump to the divide by 0 is already done. I'll execute the, like a try within a try now. Okay, I'll execute try within a, okay, it's time up. And we'll continue in the next class. Thank you. Make sure that